It's amazing how you, I feel his presence, don't you? I mean, I just feel his presence. He's here. I know he's here. Hallelujah. You do too. I see him on y'all. You know why? You've been praising him. You've been praising him. That's why we come tonight, to praise him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Don't it feel good? Praise God. I need that charge spiritually, don't you? My old deep cycle spiritual battle gets running low sometime, bud. I need it charged back up. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know, I'm always working on some message or something the Lord gives me, you know, and been working on a couple and right now. But I think the Lord changed it, and I think, you know, I'm going to preach what he give us a little word of the secret of some power. And I'm guilty. I need to get in my prayer closet more. Who's guilty of that? I am. I know I'm not getting in my prayer closet up, and I know I need to take time to get in it more. And I'm going to tell you right now. Now, me and my wife, we try to pray every day, because we pray every day, and we try to read our word and study, but there comes time you got to be alone. You got to be there, you know. And I try to pray sometimes before she gets up or something, you know, and she kind of gets off to the side sometimes and gets in the word. But you got to have time with the Lord. You got to take time. And when you do it, you're going to see things happen. And we got an example here we're going to look at, amen. And, you know, our faith is dynamos, Latin, and some of that is, it's rechargeable, you know what I mean? And we got to charge it up, because it'll run. We can get it back. We can get it back. You know, Jesus, when he went out and he ministered, he had to go to his prayer closet and do what? Pray, just like us, and build it back up. Why? He was the God-man down here and relied on the Holy Ghost. Amen? He left his deity and all his power up there, but when he was down here, praise God, and he prayed to the Father, and the Father heard him, hallelujah, and the Holy Ghost, and he got filled up with power. And when he come out of that prayer, wherever he was at, there was people got healed, set free, and delivered, and the power of God moved in an awesome way. Amen? Power. I want that power. You know, I tell you, though, it comes with a price. It does. It does. You know, I can remember Roy. He was a dedicated man in prayer. I'll just tell you about him. I love him to death. But when I, over living in the bungalow, lived over about 4 years, and that man stayed in prayer. On Saturday, he prayed, and he got up many times at 2 o'clock in the morning. God had him up, and he'd be praying. He's a better man than I was. I haven't got there yet. Now, God gets me up sometimes, and he's been getting me up here in the middle of the night sometimes. I'll start praying, and I'll pray laying there, you know, whatever, but I want to get deeper. And we as Christians, everybody, we need to get deeper in prayer, because the power of prayer, and ask God to move on us, and we'll be able to pray for our loved ones and our families and our sick ones and stuff, and the power of God to heal them and set them free, because it's his power. It's his power. Amen. I tell you right now, when you prayed up, look out. It's going to happen. I can remember many times when we would go to the prisons, and, you know, and Roy and him taught me a long time ago. Paul and Ronnie and all of us used to go, and Marquita, all of us. And we'd go down there, and, man, if we was prayed up, we was right. Amen? And the power of God moved. And guess what happened in prisons? I missed that. A lot of people got saved because they was in a situation where they had no place to look but up. Ain't that right, Paula? I tell you right now, I miss the winning of souls and being there and bringing the good news to those people. You know what I'm saying? Now, you know, like Roy, he was an evangelist, and he wasn't a pastor, but God called him to pastor. But I'll tell you what, over the years, I've seen God make a pastor out of him. He had a there before he went to be with the Lord, he had a heart of a pastor. But he was like everybody, like me. I was an evangelist, and God's called me to be a pastor now. And so I'm still bumping around, but I'm asking God to give me mercy to be the But I know he's called me. So, but some of the tools that we have, he has given us in his holy word, and we as Christians need to jump on them. That's everybody, not just the pastors. It ain't just Jeanette and her prayer closet, and my prayer closet, and BR and Nathan. It's the church's prayer closet, too. We all got to get a hold of this and do this. Amen? And I tell you, in these last days, you better be strong to stand and endure, because pestilence and all this stuff's all around us. We got things happening every day, and civil unrest and all this stuff is going on, and we got to be loaded. We got to be ready. Amen? And we got to be ready to speak to people. And you know, I yearn for people to ask me, what is the belief you got? Let me tell you what I got. His name is Jesus. Amen? You know, when I was talking, coming over here, we're seeing more and more of the Bible being fulfilled. People are falling away, y'all. I mean, think about it. They're falling away, and they don't want in God's house and the gospel. And if you try to take them out there to you, they don't want it. Get away from me, you know. Now, there is some that's hungry, but it's hard to get them because they've been bombarded with churches and Christianity all over America. Think about it. And some of them are sold out in the fires there, and some of them ain't. But you know, there's lost souls in America. There's lost souls in the world. It seems like it's easier to win souls. Paula ain't it, and Mark Eden, Becky, some of us have been there. Ruth, I think you've been there on some of our stuff. And in the prisons than it is out here on the streets. Why? Because they at their last rope and they look up, hey, I need Jesus. And when we go to the Dominican sometimes, man, them people's hungry for it. They go to church every night down there. You know what? Think about us. They go to church every night and they look forward to it. They get them streets at night when it cools down, boy, they hit them roads they out there. So I know this COVID stuff has put a damper in them from being out of streets, because that's their culture and character to be out on those streets and getting around family and everything, you know, and just a busy thing. The mopeds are running everywhere, you know, and everything. But they hungry for the word there. Amen. I've seen it. And, you know, I preached in London, England. Cultured people over there that used to be missionaries of the world, now they need revival. Now they need it, and it's just swayed right over here. America needs Bible revival now. We pray God will send missionaries on fire to come to America. Amen. But I tell you right now, you know, first time I went to the, you know, been going to the Dominican some and winning souls like God said and everything, and went to England over there, Wales and Scotland, and we had a missionary trip there. And I was able to preach over there and minister some in one of the institutions, and also pre-release, and I think it was pre-release, and young men, I was able to share the gospel, and they received it. But got out there on the streets in London. No, it was in Wales. We got out there on the street witnessing and trying to get the people to give them out tracts and all that stuff, and they didn't want them. They'd laugh at you. They'd mock you. That's where they were then. That's been 25 years ago, y'all. 25 years ago. That's where they were at then. Ain't no telling where they at today. And America's getting in the same way. They don't want God. They don't want God. I'm just telling you. And, you know, and they would. I seen them do it, mock us and laugh and everything else. The town drunk come around one time. We was out there ministering everything. But he come to the service with his booze in the little old church that we was going to minister in that night. Bill Posey got a hold of him and sat with him. And if I'm not mistaken, the town drunk got saved. So there's always that one out there that says yes. Amen. That's what we got to remember. Think about it, y'all. Let's look here and see what the word says. Appreciate Ronnie and Woody back there, I'll tell you. I've got to have glasses. Oh, thank you, Lord. I had some big old binocular glasses up here, and they drifted off somewhere. I tell you. You could really see with them things, bud. They zoom you in there, you know. Let's look and see. Got old faithfuls here. They work. Like I say, I think the Lord wanted me to change something tonight. And, you know, I'm speaking to the core of the church here tonight, you know. So let's see what God has. Pray. Pray. God wants us to pray. What is the secret of power with God? Pray. Did you know that? We're going to look at some of the secret, the power of God, and we're going to look at the example that he left us. He's up there. He's coming back. We're going to be with him, amen. But he's up there, and who's in the battle down here now? We are, ain't we? We in the battle down here, the tribulation. We are the Christian warriors and saints down here battling, and we're battling. And so we need every tool that we can get. The Bible says put on the full armor of God in Ephesians 6. Preached that in Wales in a pre-release institution, young men. I won't never forget it. I was kicking around pretty good. We got there, you know, and here comes Roy. He said, Rick, you need to give them boys some word. He hits me just like that. And I'm coming down, and I'd prepared and studied for, went over there, you know, stayed deep in it, you know. But I was coming down these big old steps. We was in a pre-release for young men to come out of prison. They would come there and work for 6 months out in the community, and then they'd go about their way. They were pre-release, you know. They had to go out and work, and then they had to come back in at night and stay there, you know. And so Roy said, I want you to, you need to give them boys some word. And so me being an old veteran, you know, I know what the warfare is. And so I was in these, and it was in a big old house that these, Dave and them had got, him and his wife, and they had opened up that pre-release thing, okay? And so it was a big old house, and upstairs, downstairs, had a bunch of rooms and everything. And I was coming down these big old wide stairs to go down there, and they was waiting on me in a big room lobby type thing with a, in there, you know, big old house. And I was coming down in big old stairs to go down there. And, you know, Roy hadn't been a few minutes. He had told me, you know, God gave me the word just like that. Bam! Put on the full armor of faith. And I preached on Ephesians 6. Put on the helmet of salvation. The breastplate of righteousness. The shield of faith. Girt your loins with truth. And sod yourself. And pick up your sword. You got to have a weapon. And I was able to relate to them some of my war stuff that I was involved in, putting on my weapons and having weapons, and then putting on the weapons of God in Ephesians 6, putting it on. You know what I'm saying? And so the power of God moved in there and touched them young men. I think some of them got saved in there too. Because I preach that gospel, amen. God is an on-time God. He's always going to be with us. But there's certain things you got to do. You got to pray up. You know, I have been so busy sometime and asked God to give me a little credit when I was going to preach, and he's done it. You know why? Because he put it in me, put the anointing there. But we got to do our part, and we got to pray up and do those things. So let's look a little bit and see. Let's see what the word says a little bit here about the secret of power with God. Let's look and see what our Lord Jesus Christ done. He's a good example, and we can relate to this. Look at here in Mark 1:35. And in the morning, rising up a great while before day. Let's talk about Jesus. He went out and departed into a solitary place. He didn't take his disciples with him, did he? He went out early, and before it said in the morning, rising up a great while before the sun, the day come up. Y'all see that? And he went out and departed into a solitary place, went by himself out there, and there he prayed. How many times have you went up or got up or in your house or whatever and got with the Lord, just got down on your knees or started prayer or get in your prayer closet? You know, I used to like to, I still do sometimes, but I like to walk and start praising God and worshiping God, and the power of God comes over me. The carnal man leaves, and the spirit man comes out, amen, and start praising God. But Jesus went into a solitary place, and there he prayed. And now this is for the sun come up. The Bible says, seek the Lord, what? Early, and you will find him. Now, I'm a morning person. I like to seek him in the morning before I go out and start everything. I usually get up right around 6:30, unless I'm really tired, you know, but get me some coffee, and then I'll get with the Lord and start praying and preparing for the day and getting in his word. I'm a morning person. I like it. In the evening, I ain't as spiffy as I am in the morning. That's why I'm a morning person, you know. But that's when I try to get with the Lord. And during the day, I pray off and on the lawnmower, something like that, you know, whatever. I talk to the Lord and whatever. But and at night, used to, we'd read a little bit or whatever, whatever's going on, you know. But usually I'm a morning person. But what did Jesus do here in the morning? And Jesus, what did he do? When he left some of these, when he was out praying, doing some of those things, he would go in another town or something like that, and he would cast out demons. And he would heal the sick and the lame and do all those supernatural powers that he, God Almighty, can do. Amen. But he prayed before he went, and he got filled up with power to do that. Okay? You see it right here. What did Jesus do? In the morning, rising up a great while before the day, he went out and departed into a solitary place. And there he prayed. Have you got a solitary place that you can go and pray? Sometimes I'll go downstairs and Becca be studying upstairs, or sometimes she'll go down there. We kind of separate sometimes so she can pray to the Lord, because sometimes you need to be by yourself. And when you're by yourself, boy, you can talk to the Lord, amen? And if you start talking to him, guess what? Sometimes you need to listen, you know? And you might get scared. He's going to tell you something you don't want to do. And he's liable to do that. You know why? Because he loves you. And he knows your heart. And he knows you'll do what he's asked you to do. Amen? Because we as Christians got to do what? In God's kingdom, when we become a child of God, we left the kingdom in this world spiritually. And we spiritually in God's kingdom. I like to preach some of that sometime about the kingdom too. Nathan does a good job about that. But we're in God's kingdom. We're not in the kingdom that's down here now. And we abide by what? God's laws first. Amen? Think about it. And some of man's laws goes against God's laws. We're against that because we serve God. But look what the word says here. It says, in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place by himself. And there he prayed. Amen? Now look here. Let's look at the next one, Matthew 14:23. He went alone to pray. Here it is again. And when he had sent the multitudes away, you know, I'm going to be honest with you. And I don't mean this in the wrong way. When I preach, sometimes the fire of God's on me. My wife can tell you. Sometimes the fire of God's on me and everything, you know, and I do what the Lord wants. All I want to do then is get away. That's just... there's something in me. And look here what Jesus done. After I fellowship with everybody and everything, I just want to get away. Look here, it says, and when he had sent the multitudes away, and like when the people leave the church in here and I preach the word of God and the fire's there and everything, you know, it's time to get away. Look here. And when he had sent the multitude away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. He went up there and prayed to God after he had ministered and poured out. He went out he went into a mountain apart, and he prayed, and he refurbished himself in the Lord. Amen? Think about it. We need to do that. You know, sometimes when we give out, we got to take time to fill back up. Y'all know that? Do you know that? When Jeanette preaches, or I preach, or Nathan, or BR, when we give it out, we got to fill it back up. It's got to be filled back up again. Amen? Think about that. And so that's why we have to pray, get in the Word, study. That's a given. You as a Christian need to pray every day, and you need to read the Word every day. You need to do that as a Christian, and I'm talking to the core of the church here. I know that we get in the Word. You know why y'all here tonight? Because you love God. It ain't cause of the preachers or nothing like that. It's cause you love God, and God says, assemble yourself in the house of God to receive what he has for you. And what are we doing here tonight? We as brothers and sisters, we're family. We started praising God, and God started touching every one of us. I could just see God moving on every one of us. Amen? And you felt his presence, didn't you, in praise. Ain't that wonderful? Man, we serve a risen God. He's alive, praise God. But some of the other things we got to do, we got to pray, y'all. It said right there, he went into the mountain apart to pray, and when the evening was come, he was there alone. He was praying and talking to the Lord. You know, that's when you get close to the Lord. Just like Jeanette right now, she's up there. She's in her Sabbath, and she's alone, and she's talking to the Lord off and on all day. She's got that time with the Lord that she can spend with the Lord. And she needs rest sometimes herself, you know. And the Lord allows her to do that. Just like Jesus, he went up. He needed rest. He had been ministering to the multitudes and pouring out. And it was time for him to withdraw and get up and get with the Lord and fill back up again. Amen? Praise God. You remember when Jesus was walking through the crowd and he was being pressed, and the woman with the issue of blood said, if I can just touch the hem of his garment. She had that kind of faith. If I can touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed. She believed that. And when she touched the hem of his garment, God's God. Jesus has got discernment. And he said, who touched me? And the disciples said, Lord, you're being pressed here. All kind of people's banging and touching and everything. We're in a crowd. He said, no, somebody touched me, because he felt virtue go out of him. Okay? And that's that anointing he felt go out. And so she humbled down and said, I touched you, Lord. And guess what? Spent all of her money on doctors and everything for 12 years and couldn't be healed, but she was healed. And she had faith. If I just touch his garment, I'll be healed. And she did, and she was healed. Think about it. Think about it. It's awesome, isn't it? Let's go a little bit further right here and look and see what God has. That's 14:23. And you know what Jesus done? In Mark 6:46, the Word of God said he sent them away. He said, and we had sent them away, he departed into a mountain to pray. You see what he done? That's just like, you know, when we get up here and preach the power of God, it's fun to fellowship and look. But the power of God moves, and everybody gets that word, and it's in them. And we just bind the devil from stealing, and the church goes, you know, everybody leaves and everything. It says right here, he departed into a mountain to pray. Amen? Praise God. Sometimes you got to be alone, and you got to pray. Let's go a little bit further right here and look. Now, this is hard to do. I've done some of it. It's hard to do. You know, because how many start praying the Lord in your bed, and you start praying, you start thinking every other thing you can think of. That's just the natural. And then you get back on prayer. And then you start thinking everything else, and you try to focus on that prayer. God, I'm sorry, Lord, I love you, and I praise you. Help so-and-so do this, Lord, and everything. And then your day's back off, and you'll be out there cutting grass all of a sudden, you know. And, you know, it just happens. And, you know, when you're praying. But especially if you're praying late at night or, you know, or something like that, you'll be, you just got to get your mind focused on talking with the Lord. Look here. And when he had sent them away, he departed into the mountain to pray. So he got by himself, didn't he? And he started praying. You see that? Because there's something about, what does it say in the Bible? Get in your what? Prayer closet. You know, I like that movie we went and seen that time. Me and Beck went and seen it. Somebody told us about it. About this woman. She's a prayer warrior. War room. And boy, she had her a little room fixed. And she went in there and she pasted that stuff up in there, and she went in there, buddy, and she done some, she was in war, spiritual warfare, and she prayed. When she walked in that room, buddy, it was on, but that was hers, and she got with God, and she got results. Amen? That's a good one. We have to see if we can find that and look at it again. Think about it. You and I, everybody here, know there's been times you've had fellowship with the Lord by yourself in your prayer closet. So you and I, even if, you know, we love our wives and we love our husbands and all that, but there's time that you individually have got to get in your prayer closet and you got to get with God alone. That's what the Lord tells us, you know. And when he had sent them away, he departed into a mountain to pray. Let's look at another right here. In 6:12, he prayed all night long. And it came to pass in those days that he went out into a mountain to pray. And he continued all night in prayer to God. Can you imagine? Now, you know, we do 15, 20 minutes, hour. But man, can you imagine all night? I read a book or something one time. I used to get in about this preacher. He would go out at a pond or something, Bud and Ruth, and he would go out there early in the morning, and he'd lay out there on that pond, and he would speak and pray in tongues all day. Come on, you know, and I will say this for my defense, Lord. They're intercessors. Y'all know what I'm talking about? You know, God's anointing. Some people can just really, they're intercessors. And I've prayed some in different languages and stuff other than my normal prayer language. But I'll tell you, two prayer warriors that we used to have in this church, and I know there's more, but they were actually called to be intercessors. Mama Porter and Sister Jean. Y'all know them? Buddy, I'm telling you right now, they prayed all week about the service here. When we went to the prisons, they prayed all week before we got in the van. And when we got in the van, the power of God was already moving. They were intercessors. Praise God for intercessors. And, you know, I don't know if God starts moving on you to be an intercessor. Or some, you know, everybody's got a calling. God's called us to do certain things. Let me give you an example. One time I was reading in a book or something, and this woman, she's had to stay at home most of the time because she couldn't. And we've got people that it's hard for them to come to church at night because, you know, getting on up in years, it's hard to drive, especially at night. But praise God, it'll be daylight when we leave here. But they would, that some of them can't come because of that. But I'll tell you this, and some of them can't come, like Cheryl Carver, she can't come. She's over there, you know, but she loves us, and she asks for prayer, and Becky talks with her some, you know, and she loves the church and everything. And she sends her tithes here and everything, but it's hard for her to come, you know, but I'll tell you this. And so this woman, she was in that predicament. You know, some women have to have their preacher on TV, and that's good because they can't come, or some people can't come out of the house. They have to be there. And so she was an elderly lady, and she got to the point she couldn't come to church and do that. And said, Lord, I want to do something. Lord, let me do something. I want to do something. I want to continue to serve you, and I want to do something. And you know what the Lord gave her as her ministry to do? You know what she was given? She can't get out or whatever, but she can be there at home. You know what he gave her to do? He said, I want you to pray for Billy Graham. So God spoke to her, and Billy Graham went all over the world preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, a powerful man of God, powerful ministry. And I love his son, Franklin. I like Franklin Graham. I read articles that he writes and some of his stuff. I like him. But I want to tell you this. That was her calling there at that time, you know, was to lift Billy Graham up to the Lord because he's all the time going in the ministries and stuff like that, you know. So think about it. We as Christians, we all got our spot in the body of Christ. Amen? And just ask the Lord, you know. But one thing, we as Christians, all of us need to stay in our prayer closet from here down. I'm telling you. The more prayer, you know, and God, we just got to ask. And when you ask, he gives it. Amen. If you don't ask, you ain't going to get it. It's tough. Prayer's hard, though, sometimes. It is. I'm telling you. Sometimes it is. It's hard. And it came to pass in those days, he went out into a mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let's look at this 9. Here's another one right here. Luke came to pass, and about 8 days after these sayings, he took Peter and John and James and went up into a mountain to pray. Now, you know, he took somebody with him here, didn't he? But you know, when he did, there's a couple of times he took Peter and James, and he was consulting with Moses or somebody in the spirit, and they seen it, and Peter said, "Lord, are we supposed to see this?" Now, that's one example that was went on. And then one time, Jesus, when he was fixing to go die on the cross, went to the Garden of Gethsemane, and he prayed so hard that drops of blood came off of his temple, and the devil's trying to kill him in the Garden of Gethsemane. But he went out there, and he took his disciples with him, and he said, "Y'all stay here, and I'm going to go a little further out there and pray to the Father." And he prayed so hard that drops of blood came from his perspiration off of his head. And he come back after it was done, and he asked the Lord. He said, "God, if you can make this cup pass from me, because the God man, let it happen. But if not, not my will, but your will." And so when he realized after he had prayed praying out there by himself, he had his disciples back there. They were supposed to have been praying too. And he prayed, and he realized, "God, I'm going to go ahead and do what you called me to do. That's what I come for." But he come back after he was out there a little ways. He come back, and he found Peter and them what? Asleep. They should have been praying, but they prayed so long probably and fell asleep. I tell you right now, should have been praying. Peter fell asleep and denied the Lord 3 times, didn't he? Think about it. And God prophesied that he would. Look right here. Let's go a little bit further right here. And in Luke 1, it says, the Bible says, "And it came to pass that he was praying in a certain place. When he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples." And this is where the Lord taught the disciples, you know, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as in heaven, give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debt as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." That's a good prayer to start out with and then start praying. But he gave them an example. And there's so much in that prayer. I've kind of preached on that prayer and dissected it before, you know. There's a lot in that prayer. I'm telling you right now. But I want to give you a couple of more scriptures here before we close. In Acts 1:14, the Word of God says, well, I don't think I gave that to Ronnie, but I didn't. Ronnie, can you pull up Acts 1:14 and Luke 24:49? We'll close with those two. God's given us the twos, y'all, but we got to do our part and pray. Praise God. And Luke 1:14. Huh? Oh, you're right. I'm sorry. Acts 1:14. There it is right there. Thank you, Ronnie. And Ronnie, be looking up. Get ready for Luke 24:49. All these continued with one accord. What was that? All these people was in the upper room. They were what? In one accord together. In unity. It says right here. And all these continued in one accord in what? Prayer and supplication. So they were praying. And with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, with his brethren. They was in one accord in prayer. And guess what happened when they were praying here? The Holy Ghost come in like a mighty rushing wind and endued them with power from on high. And you can jump back to verse 8 there in Acts 1. It says, he said, "But you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and unto the utmost part of the earth." That's awesome. Now let's look at Luke 24, Luke the physician, Luke 24:49, and see what the word, this is a good one right here. The Bible says, "And behold, I send the promise of my Father unto you, but tarry you in the city of Jerusalem till you be," what? "Endued with power from on high." So you and I have that same power that, these, our loved ones and brothers and sisters back then, they stayed and they was endued with power from the Holy Ghost. You and I have that same power today. As we get in our prayer closet, it gets more even awesome. We've been endued with that power. Hallelujah. Praise God. Ronnie, we on the camera? Let me talk to the folks on the internet. I forgot we got about 150,000 people I'm preaching to. That's right. God bless y'all for being with us. We love you so much. I pray God will touch you, every head bow. I pray God will touch you tonight. I pray God has touched your heart, and I pray you got a hold of this message, and I pray that you'll get in your prayer closet like you never have before, because the Bible says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things going to be added to you." All the benefits is in the holy word of God. Is yours. Just call on him and ask him to help you, and he will. If you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, ask him, and he'll come in your heart. Seek him. Seek his face. Seek the truth. I just lift him up to you. God bless you for being with us. God said if you believe his Son came and was crucified, died on a cross, and they buried him, and he arose on that third day, the Bible says, "Thou shalt be saved." You take it by faith. This word is truth. Hallelujah. Praise God. Ask God to reveal himself to you if you're a skeptic tonight, because God loves you, and he's concerned about you and your soul. Thank you for being with us, and we'll come Sunday morning. We'll be here live again about 11:30. God bless you so much. Now I want to pray for everybody here tonight. Father, in Jesus' holy name,